Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm a psychiatrist by choice and by profession. Whenever you know, we go to a party, sab log ye poochte hain aap kya karte ho. Unfortunately, that's the way we are talked about and addressed. So if you're an engineer, the next thing they'll ask is, kahan kaam karte ho? Now, I'm a psychiatrist. So when I say I'm a psychiatrist, first there's a pause. Then they raise that one eyebrow, and then they're thinking. They're always thinking. And then they ask me, can you read my mind? Or they'll ask me, can you read my face after talking to me for some time? Even better, can you predict the future? Now, I have done 8 years of MBBS and MD from a very reputed college in India, KEM Hospital. And unfortunately, my teachers forgot to teach me these skills. So in 8 years, I did not learn how to read someone's writing and guess their personality, or how to read a face and predict what will happen to them. These questions are sometimes not asked to a neurosurgeon or a neurologist. They also deal with the brain and the mind. So why is it that a psychiatrist is asked these questions? I think the reason is that mental illness is not considered a medical illness. Often, unlike, say, other diseases, mental illness, the people think it doesn't have a biology to it. As a result, there's a lot of stigma associated with mental illness. So when you, see media, you see TV, you see movies, there's always a mad person and there's a mad doctor who goes after the mad person. As a result, we are a very rare breed. Can you imagine there are only 5,000 psychiatrists in India? That means there's one psychiatrist for a population of 3 to 4 lakhs. So it's a stigma to be a psychiatrist as well as a patient. Now this leads to a major appalling public health issue. According to WHO, 1 in 5 people at some point is going to have a mental health illness. Look around you. If 4 of your friends seem okay, maybe you're the one. Do you know that's as common as getting dandruff? Dandruff treatment is over the counter. WHO also says that there are 400 million people suffering from some mental health issue or the other. By 2020, depression is going to be the second largest disability or the cause of disease worldwide. Yet, unlike dandruff, where everybody gets treated, only 10% of people actually seek treatment for mental health issues in developing countries. That means there's a treatment gap of 70 to 90% of people who don't seek any kind of treatment. So I'm here to address that issue. Mental illness or mental health is like medical health. Brain is a part of the body. Just like the body is made up of chemicals, the brain is a bag of chemicals. Let's treat it like one. Just like other illnesses where you have criteria to diagnose, even in mental illnesses, there are certain criteria that diagnose it. So there are certain parameters in place. Let me give you an example. Say I have a lady called Seema. Now she fails in her maths exam. She says, you know what, doc, I'm depressed. I'm feeling very, very low. And I just don't know what to do. After a few days, her friend comes and says, come on, let's go for a movie. Chal yaar. She's like, okay, fine. She feels better. She has started to feel a bit better. And by next week, she's back to school or back to college and saying, okay, next time I'll study harder. I don't think I really studied that much. Compare this to Rohan, who's also very depressed. He also has flunked in his maths. Now, Rohan, unlike the other lady, is also very low, but he refuses to eat. He refuses to sleep. He's not coming out of his room. He starts saying, I'm feeling very worthless, hopeless, helpless. Severe low self-esteem, negative thoughts. It's been 2 months, Rohan has not gone back to college. What do we think? Rohan does have signs or symptoms of depression. Why is that? Because he fulfills 5 of the symptoms or the criteria for a period of 2 weeks to be diagnosed as depression. Seema doesn't. Just like depression, you have criteria, say for panic attacks, for anxiety, for phobias. So these are not just by the by kind of words which are used. These are actually illnesses. There are criteria for it. And therefore, there is treatment for it. What is the treatment for mental illness? As I said, mind is a part of the body. So if we have medications for the body, we have medications for the mind. Many myths surrounding it. No, no, no. Medications will damage my brain. Medications will damage my body. They are addictive. I have to take them for life. Completely untrue. Medicines are fast, safe, effective, with very few side effects. We also have something called psychotherapy for mental illness. Now, psychotherapy or counseling, as it is called, is not the chit-chat or the, you know, the pep talk that your neighborhood auntie gives for free. It's a little different. The pep talk which is given by, say, a teacher or an auntie is a pep talk. Psychotherapy, again, has a biological basis. There are sessions, there are certain criteria followed, there are certain parameters followed. In fact, recent studies are showing that after giving therapy, there are permanent changes that takes place in the neuron. And therefore, there's a permanent change in thinking. There are many myths around mental health because, again, it's not considered medical health. It's a disorder, not a decision. You don't decide to feel low. You don't decide to feel anxious. Going to a baba, going to mandir, putting a black dhaga, even going for a vacation will make you feel temporarily better. But this is medical, right? If you get diabetes or malaria, do we go to a temple? No, we take treatment. So these are the myths that come with mental health, which says that, you know, don't do anything, it'll go away. That's what people say, right? You'll feel better. Come on, get out of it. No, you cannot get out of it. Can you get out of, say, diabetes or hypertension? No, you cannot. So similarly, you cannot get out of mental illness so easily. Unfortunately, because of lack of treatment, the recurrence rate is more than 50% if not treated. I'm very hopeful for the future. I hope the future of psychiatry is so bright that people will say that, you know what, let's do a blood test. And I say, oh yes, I can diagnose dementia or I can diagnose anxiety. Maybe this scan will just help me. I think that would incorporate mental health more into medical health. I also hope in the future, when I say I'm a psychiatrist, people say, oh, I went to mine last week. It was great. And finally, I hope we treat people with mental illnesses a little more sensitively, with a little more empathy, and ask them, what happened to you? Not what's wrong with you. Thank you.